Hello, and welcome to this week's episode of Geek-Minded Fools. My name's Graham.
And I'm Scott.
We are back here, once again, with part three of our review of 2016, the year that we killed. We fucked it up, really, didn't we?
We did. We did indeed.
We turned our back on podcasting and the whole
and life
thing went to shit.
In general, really, or the life of entertainment.
This is true. We're almost like superheroes. We're here to save the year.
We are. And superheroes,
to save you all.
Superheroes, as a rule, are always looking for something strange.
This is true.
In their neighbourhood.
Oh, dear. Yes, they are.
That was seamless, mate. Come on.
Yes, that was actually a really big, thick, chunky seam, isn't it?
Fair, chunky knit.
Yes.
That's what I like. Corduroy. Yeah. Come on, then.
Yes. Clearly what Scott is referring to there is the next film on our list, which is the remake, reboot, call it what you will.
Reimagining.
All-female Ghostbusters.
Ghostbusters. Gossamer Busters. Yeah. Ghostbusters, Answer the Call.
Yes, apparently. You told me is officially the title.
That is officially the title.
Why?
I suppose to differentiate it from any other films that might have a similar title.
Yes.
Because that's all this has got, isn't it, really? To kind of tie it to the original.
Yes.
Do you remember the trailer?
I do, yes.
The trailer that so brilliantly told us that 20 years ago, four scientists, even though there are only actually three and one guy who would do anything for money,
yeah,
saved the world, leading us to believe that this reboot, reimagining, refranchising, are part of the same universe, but they're really not, are they?
Really not, no.
Because in this universe, the Ghostbusters have never existed.
This is true. These are all new girly Ghostbusters.
Indeed. And, I mean, with that said, let's move on to the next item. do you know what? I don't actually know what you thought of it. You know, you've been very coy about it, in fact.
Yes,
And I feel this is probably because deep down inside, you love you some female Ghostbusters.
I did. I absolutely adored it. Now, if I'm completely honest, you obviously will remember that when we were recording last year, every bit of news you delivered in the Monkey Farm about the new all-female Ghostbusters, I ranted about. Not
you
because
did.
It was all-female. I have no problem with that at all. I just didn't think we needed another Ghostbusters film.
Yeah.
It seemed like lazy filmmaking to me. There's enough original ideas out there not to have to rehash over the old stuff. So I came into this with pretty low expectations. I mean, if I'm honest with you, I think that the performances of the four main females were very good.
I agree. Let's just look at the cast for a second.
Yes.
You've got Leslie Jones.
Yep.
Melissa McCarthy.
Yep.
Kristen Wiig.
Yep.
And Kate McKinnon.
Indeed.
And you see, Graham, that's the beauty of being able to re-record certain bits of a podcast, because you can remember all the names of the actors.
This is true.
Who are in a film.
Yes.
I didn't have a problem with any of their performances.
As
I seem to remember you saying
earlier on
in a previous recording of this podcast.
I thought that Kate McKinnon was really good. I actually think that she stole the film. She was the one that I expected to annoy me the most, but I thought she was really good.
And for me, it was Leslie Jones, because I hated her in the trailer. But
she, again, a really strong performance. And you could see the chemistry they've had from the Saturday Night Live days.
Yeah.
And the same with Kristen Wiig and Melissa McCarthy. You know, they've obviously been in Bridesmaids together, and you know, you could see they played well off each other. And I felt performance wise they were absolutely fine. The problem was the material they were dealing with.
Yeah.
But I know this is going to be a funny thing to say, bearing in mind that a lot of criticism, I mean, Leslie Jones left Twitter because of the shit she got about the first trailer and some
horrifically awful racist shit that she got.
And it being an all-female Ghostbusters. But one thing that did bother me about it was the Chris Hemsworth character.
Yeah.
You know, playing their secretary come PA.
Kind of airhead.
Yes, indeed. Because Kristen Wiig's character, her sort of relationship and her feelings towards him were, to me, exactly what we're trying to get away from by having an all-female Ghostbusters.
Exactly.
You don't want sexism applied, and yet
you've resorted to it as part of your plot.
Sort of, you know, reverse sexism with a female character being sexist towards a male character and fawning over them and sort of reducing them to a piece of meat. And
at one point she drinks coffee that he spat out. You wouldn't do that with someone that you actually did fancy in real life, would
precisely.
You?
Precisely.
Well, I don't know.
And I think if you're making the feminist point of saying we're going to have an all-female Ghostbusters cast, why reduce yourselves by having a very sexist stereotype that, were it the other way round, would be very deeply frowned upon?
It would receive a huge backlash if those characters were reversed in sex, yeah. Definitely.
And I just felt that it was unnecessary and against what you're trying to promote by having this film cast, particularly knowing the stick you've got. As soon as it was announced, people were saying, we don't need a female Ghostbusters. Me, I just don't think we need another Ghostbusters, whether they're
which
female
was the B-side
or,
to We Don't Need Another Hero, obviously.
And that was all. But other than that, I thought Hemsworth played it quite well. I thought his comic delivery and his character was okay.
I think he's definitely got amazingly good comedy chops.
Yep.
But one thing his character, and it's definitely not Chris Hemsworth as an actor, suffers from throughout that film, is he over-jokes. He kind of will deliver what will be a relatively funny line or a funny setup for a joke.
Yeah.
And then he'll just go that one step too far. Yeah. And I don't mean by, you know, the politically incorrect one step too far, just that one step too far to make the joke then fall
yes,
flat.
Absolutely. Yes. Flogging a dead horse, kind of thing, you know.
Perfect. Exactly the words that need to be said. In fact, the entire film should have been subtitled Flogging a Dead Ghost.
Yeah. Yes. Very good. But again, things like Slimer and Mrs. Slimer driving around in the car, just
let's really skip over that quickly,
yeah.
Because it is, do you know how they tried to explain that away?
Go
that
on.
Scene, you obviously will know this. The original Ghostbusters was supposed to have John Belushi,
yes,
in it. So obviously, unfortunately, John Belushi passed away, didn't he? So Slimer in the original,
of course,
is
yes,
supposed
was,
to be that
John
Belushi character.
Yeah.
This is supposed to again be homage to John Belushi and how he used to like to take joyrides with friends and get drunk in a car.
Oh,
yeah, exactly. I could accept it from people like Ivan Reitman and from, you know, Harold Ramis, but from Paul Feig, who has no kind of investment or knowledge of these, you know, these characters or this universe or of John Belushi, I would doubt, to be honest. I don't think he's really got, you know, any legs to stand on to make that kind of joke.
No,
so
I agree.
Let's push that out the door.
But another thing I felt deeply uncomfortable about was the cameos of the original cast, which I thought were just appalling across the board.
And they got a little bit worse as each one became a little bit worse.
Well, Bill Murray was just horribly embarrassing. And to me, if you're going to do this, separate yourself completely. I mean, this film would have been a lot better had it not been a Ghostbusters film. If you just made it a film about four paranormal investigating women, fine, no problem at all. But to me, it almost reeks of desperation that you're saying, right, to try and give this, you know, more credence. You know, we're going
to have to have the original cast involved.
Yeah. But Murray was embarrassing. I mean, Dan Aykroyd as a cab driver was blink and you'll miss him.
Yeah.
Ernie Hudson as Leslie Jones's dad was, you know, just
stereotyping.
Annie Potts as the hotel manager, and obviously Sigourney Weaver with a ridiculous post-credits cameo. And it embarrassed me, and it kind of made me think, why are you guys cheapening yourself just to try and give this film a pop? Let this film stand on its own feet without having to get dragged down by this.
Do you know what, thinking about it, probably the best cameo was the Harold Ramis one.
What was that? Oh, yeah.
You see a bust of his head.
Yes.
That worked. That was fine.
But didn't need
to be there, but at least that worked better than the others. And I do have to say, my goodness, Annie Potts has held up well, hasn't she?
Yes, yes.
Still looks beautiful. I've always had such a crush on Annie Potts. How unmemorable is that villain?
Oh, just
so
rubbish. Terrible.
I cannot remember what he looks like. I can't remember the character's name.
What's his character's name? Yeah.
I don't even remember why he wanted to do the shit he wanted to do.
Yeah.
And that was while I was watching the film, let alone kind of trying to reminisce on it now.
Yeah.
But I think, for me, the biggest kind of injustice in the whole film is to take a beloved character like the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man and effectively turn him into a Macy's Day Parade
balloon
float thing
that
gets taken out by a pocket knife
being
stuck in his arse.
And it
could have been stuck anywhere, couldn't it? It could have been put in the foot. Could have been put anywhere, but no, they do make a point of sticking a knife up his arse.
Yeah.
And then they take out the big bad, who incidentally was based on the logo from the animated series.
Yeah.
By kicking him in the balls.
Yeah.
I mean,
it's just cheap Route 1 comedy, isn't it? Not even comedy.
Not even Route 1. This is more kind of like a lay-by. There's just no redeeming feature about it at all.
No.
I mean, the only kind of saving grace of the film is the fact that they took out the song and dance number that was in it.
All right.
Did you watch the credit sequence?
No.
You didn't? Okay, no. Well, probably for the best, really, because there is a song and dance routine at the end with Chris Hemsworth, or a possessed Chris Hemsworth, who makes the entire army and all the police who have turned up in Times Square go into the John Travolta pose. And he has them all frozen there. And then he starts a big dance routine just to show that he can control everyone. Mm. It is fucking awful.
Terrible.
A terrible, terrible film. Incidentally, if you didn't watch that credit sequence, you didn't see the stinger then either, did you?
Oh, what's the stinger?
The stinger is them all...
Oh, Zool.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's Leslie Jones.
I did see that.
Yeah.
So I must have seen the song and dance routine.
Because Leslie Jones, obviously the member of the team who has got absolutely no experience in any of this at all, is going through all these paranormal tapes at the end, isn't she? And she hears that. And who's Zool?
Zool? Yes.
So like, Zool is a property that you will never get your hands on, kids. Okay? Because no.
Yeah.
Well, we fucking hope. Anyway.
It was a shame because it was a decent cast, and I thought it was just poorly plotted, poorly scripted, and just unnecessary Route 1 comedy at times.
Indeed, and I really cannot reiterate
good talent.
Yeah, and I cannot reiterate enough. From my point of view, this was nothing to do with the cast being female.
No,
this was nothing to do with the Ghostbusters.
I liked them all.
They were really good. They are really good as actors.
Yeah.
It's all to do with the fact that, you know, this just did not need to be made.
No.
This is for money. This is for a cash in. Yeah. Unlike us kids, we are not doing this for the money. Yeah. We're doing this to save your 2017.
If you want to have a really good vehicle for these four clearly very funny and talented women, come up with something original. There's a million and one original ideas out there. Why do you have to, you know, go to Dan Aykroyd and just rehash his franchise that he's desperately trying to get out there?
So he can sell some more lunchboxes
and
sit back and drink his Crystal Skull vodka.
Hmm.
Humbug. Right, next.
Next we have is a show that it just had one pilot episode on Amazon Prime, and that was the superhero The Tick.
Spoon!
Starring Peter Serafinowicz.
I did not see this, and I didn't even know it existed.
Oh, okay.
Now, I do remember they did a live action Tick show, didn't they, in the
90s? Yeah.
Which was it Patrick Warburton playing the Tick?
I think
is the voice of Joe in Family Guy, is he not?
Okay.
And I loved that. I thought it was brilliant. I've always loved the Tick. I think the Tick's an amazingly funny character. But did not see this, so please tell me it was good.
It was okay.
Is it Serafinowicz playing the Tick?
Yes, he is the
Tick. Good choice.
Yes, and sort of plays it really well. He's this almost laughable character, and you know, when you first see him, you do think, oh my God, he's just some screwball, until you see bullets bouncing off him and him having superpowers. But he just has this, maybe not childlike, but certainly a very innocent sense of justice. And of course, it focuses around Arthur Everest, I think his name is, and the fact that he's had mental health problems since his dad, who is very close to him, it sort of showed a flashback, and when he was a boy, his sort of dad went over the road to put money in the parking meter, and the ship of the superhero team crashed on him and killed him, and then the superhero team sort of staggered out, and they've been blinded by the forces of a supervillain called the Terror, played by Jackie Earle Haley. He'd weaponized syphilis and blinded them all with weaponized syphilis, and then they killed them all in front of him. And sort of, there's this great moment where Jackie Earle Haley comes over to little Kenny and goes, "Hey, little boy, what's up? Why are you crying?" And then he goes, "What's that behind your ear?" And he reaches behind him and he goes, "Oh, it's nothing."
That's definitely going on the Christmas list as well. For one reason and one reason alone. Weaponised syphilis. That's what everyone wants for Christmas,
absolutely.
Surely.
So Arthur obviously becomes, at the end of the episode, he becomes the Tick's sidekick.
Indeed.
And his sort of sister is his guardian because his parents are dead, and like I say, he's on various medication, and he's sort of always trying to hunt down the terror, and that's how he meets the Ticks. He's spying on the terror's gang, and suddenly the Ticks and so on. And yeah, for a half hour episode, it packed plenty in and looked promising, so hopefully it will have been greenlit for a series, and we'll get more of it, because it was delightfully oddball and
irreverent.
Yes. And
has the Tick got the trademark costume?
Yes.
Yeah. Has he got the moving antennae?
They are moving. Yes.
The Deely Boppers. Yes. Good. Now, do you know what? I might even watch that tonight. To be honest.
Okay. Good stuff.
So this was one of the Amazon do these things every now and again, don't they? Where they have pilot episodes. And,
yes, absolutely.
And more often than not, the shit ones get through, don't they?
Yes,
I think so. They did Delta House. Was it not Delta House? It was a thing about politicians living together with John Goodman. I can't remember what it was called.
Living Together with John Goodman.
Living Together with John Goodman. That would be awful, wouldn't it?
Yeah, that would be great.
There'd be no food in the fridge. Ever.
So yes, check it out. That was good.
Top marks for the Tick then.
Yes.
Good.
A Tick for the Tick.
Good.
Next on the list, we have the Netflix exclusive series, Stranger Things.
Uh-huh.
Ooh.
Yes.
Very Twin Peaks-esque, wasn't it?
You cannot deny that at all, can you? No. From the moment that I pressed play on this to the moment I stopped watching it, I was absolutely enthralled with
Absolutely.
It.
Absolutely.
And what a beautiful soundtrack.
The authenticity of the 80s setting.
Perfect. Lovingly
spot
done.
On. Yes.
Might as well have been filmed by an 80s Spielberg or Joe Johnston or someone like that. It was bloody well done.
I mean, it had been out for a week before I got a chance to watch it, and somebody said to me, oh, it's E.T. meets the Goonies meets Twin Peaks. And I thought, oh, fuck off. But I watched it and I thought, no, they were pretty spot on. That says it all.
Was that not me that said that?
No, wasn't. No.
Because I described it as that to someone as well.
Oh, okay.
It's exactly, word for word, what my description was.
It was somebody at work.
Yeah. Actually, I tell a lie. I described it as the Goonies meets... you've thrown me there. Graham just mouthed something at me. I'm not sure what it was, but I think it was, I want to fuck you. So I think we're probably trying to move through Stranger Things pretty quickly.
Stranger Things.
How many episodes did it run for? Was it eight? It was eight, wasn't it?
It was eight episodes.
Which is, again, odd for a show, isn't it? Because most shows go for 13 episodes on their first season, don't they?
Yeah, but this was obviously Netflix exclusive, so
of course,
all
yeah.
bets are off.
All bets are off, indeed. I tell you what, Winona Ryder was a bit good, isn't it?
Do you know what, that's exactly the next thing I was going to say. What a fucking excellent term for somebody who's very much been off the radar to come back and deliver something that good as the desperate mother who no one believes.
And also gave 2016, I think, probably one of the most inventive Halloween costumes that I saw. It was a girl who had basically dressed up in the ratty jumper, and she'd done a big bit of cardboard that she had behind her with loads of letters on it, and then all the Christmas lights. Oh, that was really, really clever. What a great show, though. All the kids
very,
were brilliant.
Very dark and scary as well. Yeah. Obviously, the what's it called? The Upside Down...
it was called The Upside Down.
Was brilliantly done and brilliantly realised, and
those scary monsters
in there were really fucking good. So, but as you say, yeah, kids were good. Obviously, the girl who played
11L
was really good, and obviously, you know, for a kid that young to have to shave all her hair off can't have been easy. But
no, indeed, I thought that the three young male leads were quite effortless in their kind of chemistry together. Mm-hmm. I believe that they were friends, and I
Absolutely.
Think that's what kept me watching it.
Yeah.
And I believe that little rift between, you know, the when they had the little argument and that the fight scene was really, really good.
Yeah.
But for me, one of the standout scenes was, I can't remember the main character's name, the young boy, but it was when he was made to jump off the cliff in order to stop Matey Boy stabbing him.
And L held him there, yeah.
But I just thought that was a really strong scene, because he didn't know El was there, did he? And it was that really kind of... I thought that was really heart-wrenching.
Yeah.
That he loved his friend so much that he would have died to stop him even just getting hurt.
Yeah.
It was a really, really good show. Also as well, massive, massive kudos to the chap playing the sheriff, who I love.
Yes.
How good was he?
Who I kept thinking, where do I know him from? Where do I know him from? And I suddenly realised he was one of the newsreaders in the newsroom. Which was the
William Hurt?
Aaron Sorkin? No. That was a movie. No, there was a TV show called The Newsroom.
Right. Okay. I'm thinking of broadcast news.
Yes,
aren't I?
Indeed. With Jeff Daniels. No, is it Jeff Daniels? No,
from Dumb and Dumberer?
Yes.
Is his name Jeff Daniels? Is it not Adam Sampras?
Who is this Adam Sampras dude? Who is this Jeff Daniels?
God, there's a throwback.
Isn't it? Jeff Daniels. Yes, Paul Daniels' son. I remember seeing that film and thinking, I like this.
Oh, dear.
But not a lot. That's a slow burner for you, my friend.
Very, very good.
I think we both loved Stranger Things, yes, did we not?
We did.
I think, in all honesty, bar the fact that this year gave us, obviously, Daredevil and, you know, for a lesser extent, things like Agent Carter and Legends of Tomorrow, Preacher. TV-wise, Stranger Things, I think, has been the strongest TV show in 2016.
Right up there. Yeah, definitely. Definitely. But then the great thing is that you go back 10, 15, 20 years and a movie star ending up having to be on a TV show was the death of their career. TV was the graveyard of your career.
Are we talking Winona Ryder here?
No, but with now production values, TV is right up there with movies.
Very much,
which is why you'll get big names doing TV shows
because if it's a success, they could run for 5 or 6 or 7 seasons, much like Walking Dead has. Andrew Lincoln's surely all right for a bit of cash now, isn't he? After The Walking Dead,
absolutely,
pretty good since he's played the same character very, very well throughout the 7 seasons. I wonder what they're going to do if we run a second season of Stranger Things.
And we are. There is going to be a sequel.
I wonder if we're going to go the same route that True Detective went by just completely changing up the characters. I don't know. Did you watch True Detective?
No.
I watched
episode 1 of season 1 and
then just didn't get it. See, I really liked that. But the second season... Sorry, I'm diverting a little bit. But the second season was so very different from the first. Yes. It just made it unbearable. I hope they don't do that with Stranger Things, but let's wait and see. When's that pegged for? Is that 2017?
I think next year, yeah, because they've announced some new cast.
I haven't heard anything about it, to be honest.
Sean Astin might be in it.
Mr. Frodo? That's Sean Astin, isn't it? I don't know why all of a sudden he's become gay West Country. Oh, Mr. Frodo, sir! Your little dinkle's gone inside me.
Mikey from the Goonies.
Mikey, indeed, yes. Yeah, not little anymore, is he? He's a big chap, Sean Astin. Wide. Got a wide head. Much like Haley Joel Osment.
Yeah,
who
big
should
head.
Always keep a hat
big
on.
Big ass head, yeah.
Always keep it. Did you ever see Tusk? Did you watch Tusk in the end?
Yes, I did.
He's got a big head,
isn't
he?
He's got a big ass head, yes.
That wasn't a prosthetic either. That's his own head.
No, why would he be wearing a prosthetic head?
Well, I think he needs to.
He needs a head reduction.
Head is actor's own. On his headshots, he has to have them turn up like on a flatbed. Oh, Haley Joel Osment, I'm sorry. I loved you in Sixth Sense. Everything else I saw you in, I don't know you weren't in anything else.
He loves you.
I love you. Go on then, my friend. What else happened?
Next one, we have the movie Blair Witch.
The
sequel stroke reboot of the horror franchise. Now, you and I were massive fans of the Blair Witch Project.
Right, and if you look just down to the left of you there...
Oh, yes. That is the little box I gave you.
That is. And that is actually, Graham, now where I keep my drugs.
Oh, that's lovely.
Isn't it? That's been through the walls, that.
It's a little carved wooden box with the Blair Witch Project on it that I bought with some trading cards in it. And I gave you the box for your drugs, obviously.
How many years ago did you give me that? Long time.
Yeah, mid-2000s,
Long, long time ago. I am a huge Blair Witch fan, yes. You know I am.
We love you are, the, the whole history they
gave. Yeah, the whole Rustin Parr and Ellie Kedwood and the Coffin Rock kind of history.
Absolutely.
We will completely and utterly wipe the Blair Witch Project 2, or Blair Witch 2 as it's called, from memory. Because
Book of Shadows, Blair Witch 2.
That was it, there you go. See, I can't even remember the title.
The only reason I think both of us own that is because of the documentaries that it has in it about the initial film, about the history.
And there's a really good Dave Grohl track in the soundtrack.
Yes, that's
by
true.
Probot, I think. And with Lemmy in it. What did you think of the... I don't know if we can call this a reboot or a reimagining, because it is set in the same universe. I think it's a more true sequel than Book of Shadows is.
Yes, it is, yes. Because this is the premise that... This is set far into the future of the original Blair Witch Project film, and it's the younger brother of Heather,
Yes.
Who was apparently four when she disappeared, and he's always wanted to try and find her. And so he's now, well, I guess, early 20s, and wants to go into the woods to try and find the house, Rustin Parr's house, that they obviously showed her going into in the footage. And so he...
But the reason they've gone there, isn't it, is that they've been kind of...
they found a video online.
That's right.
Which these guys found.
Out in the woods in Burkittsville.
Yes, and they've seen it, and it freezes on what he thinks is Heather's face.
Yes.
So he wants to go and try and find her. So he recruits some friends of his. There's a girl who's goes to film school, who wants to make a documentary of it. And
they're their two friends,
two friends, and they go and visit the people who put this video online, and they sort of a couple of local hicks, a man and a woman, and they say, "We'll show you where we found it, but we want to come with you.
We want
to
camp out
with you." So they have to take them, and then what happens from then on is pretty much a complete remake of the Blair Witch Project.
Yeah, it's your standard fare, isn't it? But you've not answered my question though. Did you like it?
Not really, no.
No, I didn't think you would, actually. And do you know what? Do you remember me saying a couple of episodes back that there might even be some films on here that I'd initially said to you I liked?
Right.
And now probably don't like them as much as I thought I did. That's one of them.
Right, okay.
In fact, that's the one.
Right.
I thought it was very... I thought it had a great idea.
It was a good premise, and I was really looking forward to it. But as soon as we got there... My problem with most films is, particularly horror films, if you're going to root for a character, you have to care for them.
Yes.
And I felt that immediately these characters came across as deeply unlikable.
Yeah.
Particularly the two friends, the black guy and the black girl.
Yes.
When they met
him in particular.
Yeah. When they met the two hicks, he was very rude to them. They were they were telling him stuff, and he was just openly laughing in this guy's face. Yeah. This guy was obviously a bit of a strange case and ended up making the stick figures to try and scare them because he knew there was stuff going on out there and he wanted to prove it to them.
He only makes the first lot, doesn't he?
Yes, yeah. Yes, that's right. And this guy's just laughing at him, and the girl's playing along with it. And frankly, you know, the trouble is, if there's people in peril, when that guy went out on his own at night and, you know, was it a tree fell on him or something, and then all kinds of stuff, you just kind of saying, mate, you're a dick, I don't care.
I hope you do die.
I don't fucking care, you're a prick.
Yeah.
And that's a problem, and that's a lesson that so many horror makers seem to fail to learn, is I only care about your characters being in peril if I care about your characters. Yeah. And if I don't, then... fuck them.
And that is what made the original Blair Witch Project such a successful film.
Because you've followed their story. It wasn't them immediately being in the woods. Yeah. It was them going around talking to people, interviewing the old woman and all that sort of thing. And then slowly you followed them. And you know, they were good people and you went on their journey with them. What I didn't like about this one was the fact that only one person was making a documentary about it. But everybody had these ear cameras on, so that everybody was filming. The two hicks that were there, they both had cameras, so everybody's walking around with cameras, so you know, the
and footage, the drone,
oh god, and the footage was edited together sort of from everyone's perspective, and it just made, you know, before, you know, there was three of them, they had two cameras between them, they had the colour one and the big black and white one. Yeah. This one, there was too much, you know, and you'd have conversations between two people who are looking at each other, and it would edit backwards and forwards between both of their POVs. It was a bit like an episode of fucking Peep Show.
It was exactly like an episode of Peep Show. Do you know what threw me out of it?
Go on.
Because I watched it the first time, and I watched it, and I thought, do you know what, that was all right. That wasn't the worst horror film I've seen. Mm. Because obviously, the horror genre, you know how much I love it. It has a lot of misses, the horror genre. It really does. More so than any other genre, I think.
Of course.
And this one, I kind of felt, I'm going to give that a pass because I can see what they've tried to do and I quite like it. But then watching it again, there's the scene where they first pull up to the woods and you've got the two hicks. Mm. And as you rightly said, they've all got cameras. Why would they be filming as they pull up to the woods?
I know.
But all she is filming is his face.
Yes.
To give you that exposition of him being a little bit crazy.
And also...
So, like, what, are you filming this just in case you do go missing and someone later on finds all the footage and edits it together?
The fact that when they're driving up, you know, you've got the shots from one car and in his car, they're listening to metal. And it's like, you know, come on, you're kind of pounding us with the stereotypes here.
Yeah.
But yeah, I just felt unlikable people, stupid circumstances. But they love this bit where... when they cut from one scene to another, the new scene would always start with a of a camera to try and get you that jump. Nothing's happened, but you're kind of, oh God, you know. And it was like, and after a while, you're just like, for fuck's sake. And there was so much of the, sort of like the film, fake editing, you know, freezing and that sort of thing. And after a while, you just think, in the modern day, you wouldn't have all those.
That's the biggest problem problems. With it. It is the biggest problem and with the film. There's too many glitches throughout it which wouldn't be there.
Precisely. And therefore, for a lot of it, you don't know what the fuck's going on. It's dark, things are jumping. You're like, you know, you know, I don't know what's happening right now.
The reason it works so well in the first one, that though, all those glitches and those little camera hiccups, is because they're actually there.
Yeah.
And the footage that they took, those actors are taking that footage. And it's not these headcam things or GoPros. Like I say, I understand what they've tried to do with this one. They've tried to update it and they've tried to bring it into the now. And I like the fact that they... they've tried to give you more about the kind of whole Blair Witch mythos, if you like. The fact that the woods are constantly trying to keep you in.
But this is something that I didn't understand. Heather's younger brother kept referring to Heather's footage.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, we saw that in Heather's footage. We saw that in Heather's footage.
Yeah.
So does that mean that in their world,
yeah,
the Blair Witch Project was released as a film?
Yes.
So... how is it when the Hick girl was telling them about the history of the Blair Witch and everything that happened, would they not have known that by watching the first fucking film? We all did.
Why? Oh, actually, no, thinking about it, no. The Blair Witch Project as a film, as a documentary, does not exist in their world.
So,
but the footage has been found.
Okay.
Because you said at the top of this that she disappeared when she was four.
No, when he was four.
When he was four.
Yes.
I thought... he hadn't. I thought he was a bit older than that. I thought he was supposed to be.
No. He actually said in the film he was four.
My apologies, I misheard you.
But if he's seen her footage,
yeah.
Heather's footage, a lot of the footage was her interviewing people and finding out the story of the Blair Witch.
Yeah.
So therefore, surely, they already knew the story that Hick girl was telling them. She was telling them all of the history about it. We already knew it, but because we've seen the Blair Witch Project.
Yeah.
If he's seen the footage, then surely he knows it. She was just telling them stuff that we knew already. It was just...
no, you are right. Maybe he was just a little more polite than his, the other character.
It just didn't ring true to me. But one thing that was so blatantly obvious was the fact that the footage that the people put online that they had found would end up being the footage that these people...
the loop.
...filmed, yes.
That's the one element of it that I quite like.
Yeah, but they...
And hate at the same time.
Because it was so obviously going to happen.
Yeah. The theory that I've read on the film is that the two Hicks go and find that footage.
Hmm.
And once they're in the woods and they find that footage, they are then taken over by the Blair Witch. And they are the Rustin Pars. So they are then bringing fresh children to the woods, the four people. And then the Blair Witch that we see at the end is not the Blair Witch. That's Heather.
Right.
So, again, as I say, I thought
Heather was killed at the end of the Blair Witch Project.
You never see anyone get killed,
yeah,
do you?
Yeah, but you're... and then
you do, yeah, but you never see anyone die.
She goes down. No, quite, because it's all POV.
Yeah.
But surely the assumption was Heather had died. Now...
that was my assumption,
now,
definitely.
If the Hick girl had been taken over by the Blair Witch, why, when the guy ran off because he thought they were a hallucination because they'd been out there in the dark for 5 days, even though it was one day for these people, the girl stays with them, finds her hair tied around one of the stick figures, and when the black girl says, oh, you're being ridiculous, and breaks the stick figure, she breaks her in half. Why would that happen if she was in cahoots with a Blair Witch? Surely she was a victim.
Yeah, this is a very good point.
So
maybe that theory is a bit moot.
It's a bit cock.
I mean, on the whole, I saw what they tried to do, and on first viewing, quite enjoyed it. On second viewing, quite annoyed me and thought it was actually a little bit disrespectful to the original film. I do like the premise of the time loop thing. I think if it had been done better, it would have been more impactful, more effective.
Mm.
And I do like the fact that the only thing I did like about the drone was the shots that go up that kind of make you believe that the woods are kind of closing in on you.
Yeah.
I thought that was really, really effective.
Well, the fact that when they're climbing up, yeah, and it was just woods everywhere, because she said, you know, are there no clearings we can look in? And she was like, no, and it was just woods everywhere. So yeah, that was a clever
device. I think if I had to point out one thing that I thought was the worst thing of the entire film, it was the scene in the tent when the thing flies out of her foot.
Yes.
Because I had no explanation for it. And the worst thing about it was they had no explanation for it either. Mm-hmm. So it was pointless. It's almost like a whole big bit of the film got excised and kind of just removed because there was no explanation for it. I think it could have been brilliant, but unfortunately it wasn't.
It really wasn't.
I don't think it's marred the original in any way, shape or form, but I certainly don't think it's going to invite a new audience.
No, definitely not.
Unfortunate.
Yep. Okay, next one we have is the Netflix exclusive Marvel series, Luke Cage.
Luke Cage. He's a good looking boy, isn't he? Good looking boy, plays Luke Cage.
Good looking lad. Yes.
Good looking lad. In fact, the majority of the Marvel TV universe have been real good looking people, I think. And that's what I think sets it aside from the DC universe.
Is Marvel turning you gay?
I think it might be a little bit. Only a little, though.
We're all a little bit gay.
Every day. I really, really like Luke Cage. Again, yeah. I didn't know if I was going to like it. But I tell you what, I actually think I enjoyed it a little bit more in some places than I did Daredevil.
Both Daredevil series?
Yeah. I don't know why, but there was just something
about it.
No, I know, I know, it's hard, isn't it? But there was just something about it that kind of made it very, very different from any show I've seen of that ilk.
No, as a superhero, you know, in inverted commas, series, it definitely trod its own path.
It had some great, great standout moments, like the kind of the what I'm going to refer to as, and this is much, much later on in the season, but the I Am Spartacus moment, I like to call it, where they all end up wearing the holy hoodies. Which I thought was so brilliantly done. Because I hadn't even kind of picked up on that. I hadn't even thought about that. But I also love the fact that they have written in the fact that he's going to keep constantly having ruined clothes.
Yeah.
And I thought that was so smart.
I mean,
massive props to the entire cast as well.
Yes, absolutely. I mean,
sorry, I cut over you there. Please.
That's fine.
Some love.
I really like Misty Knight. I thought, to me, she was a standout character.
Yeah.
I thought she was superbly played. In terms of how she was used in her relationship with Luke Cage, you know, this sort of potential bubbling under type relationship thing until, obviously, the lovely Rosario Claire steals him off that one. But I just felt her battling against, you know, the corruption within the Force.
Within the Force, yeah. She played it really well, didn't
absolutely,
she?
Absolutely, really.
Played cool. It really, really well.
I mean, if I have one disappointment within the series, it's that Cottonmouth didn't make it to the end.
Yeah.
Because I thought Cottonmouth
was going to be the big bad.
Yes, and was a much better and darker and meaner baddie. Because Diamondback, when he came in and was sort of the big bad for the rest of the show, I felt he was a bit more of a pantomime villain. He was too over the top, whereas Cottonmouth was so sort of underplayed but menacing that I'd have preferred to see Cottonmouth go all the way with him.
Diamondback almost was too much of a comic book villain.
Absolutely, yeah.
That didn't really fit in a TV universe.
Yeah, it was.
I could not agree with you more. Cottonmouth should have been.
You know, he was too sort of moustache twiddling.
Exactly.
Type of villain.
He didn't seem to fit as well as the rest of the characters, although I wouldn't say that just he on his own ruined the show.
But nothing ruined the show. Because, I mean, obviously, Alfre Woodard as Black Mariah was
jaw-dropping.
Was superbly good.
Jaw-dropping.
The difference between the public persona and this sort of raging psychopath behind closed doors was brilliantly played.
Much like Jeffrey Dean Morgan in Walking Dead as Negan, she's petrifying to me.
Yes, absolutely.
Really petrifying, because she's that kind of character that would kind of stab you in the back. And they're the scariest characters.
When she lost her temper, obviously, particularly when she killed Cottonmouth, but when she lost her temper, it was like, holy shit. You know? Even though it's just a character you're watching on telly, you're kind of like taking a step back and go, whoa, you know.
No, indeed. It's an absolute triumph, I think, again, for Marvel. For me, Marvel have only made one misstep in their TV programming, and that's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. I just find it very dull.
Right.
I find it actually really, really boring.
I mean,
and it's a shame, because I know a lot of people love it.
I haven't watched season 4 yet, but obviously Ghost Rider's in it.
Yes, it's a different Ghost Rider, though, isn't it?
So I'm actually sort of quite looking forward to seeing what they do with that. But yeah, another character I really enjoyed, Shades.
Yep.
I thought he was really good.
He's a great actor as well. He's always good in whatever he shows up in. And now, the relationship between him and Mariah was really, really good. It's really kind of like seedy, but kind of sexy, but bubbling under will they, won't they? No, they're not going to. Yes. Oh, it was very, very cool. the whole flashback episode with, well, I say episode, but the episode that featured the flashbacks of Cottonmouth and how he became Cottonmouth, I thought was one of the strongest episodes in the entire season.
He's there playing the piano in the
what a brilliant premise as well, because I mean they genuinely have really thought about what kind of people would have been around in Harlem in those kind of that kind of time, and they paid real great attention, I think, to the entire kind of set dressing of the show throughout each era and year that it sits in. But I must say, I really genuinely thought the opening credits as well were very beautifully done. I think they've been the best opening credits on any Marvel show either.
I mean,
I think the Daredevil.
The one time I watched them, they were really good.
Yeah, you're much like me. You do. Yeah, exactly. I do the same thing.
Fast forward.
Yeah, but every now and again, I will watch them because I like the theme tune is really good as well. It's almost got a kind of just across 110th Street vibe to it, which is, you know, again, very much set in that kind of that Harlem.
But it's interesting you saying about Harlem, because there was a great use of that area, and Harlem was almost a character itself,
you know,
within the show.
Much like Hell's Kitchen is in Daredevil. And I think that, again, is a very, very clever piece of storytelling that they have ripped directly from comic book writers. Mm. Yeah, I mean, comic book writers are very good at making the venue the character, aren't they? And I think, as I say, they've pulled that very nicely from the comics. I can't wait for season two. I really can't.
Yeah.
I hope if we get another season of Jessica Jones that it's a bit better, because I like seeing those characters interact, and if I had to have any one problem with Luke Cage is that there was no real mention of her
throughout. Sure. I mean,
I feel she should have been mentioned.
In fact, at one point I wasn't sure if this, because there was no mention of it, had been set before Jessica Jones, but then of course there was various mentions of things you realised it was set after. But one thing I did like was the fact that Rosario Dawson got a lot more screen time than she has done previously in the Daredevil shows, which I thought was good.
Yeah, and she is now becoming that night nurse character, isn't she?
Yeah.
For me, though, out of the entire show, the standout moment, again, in flashback, was him becoming Luke Cage.
Yes.
Just when he's got the headband and then stealing the shirt from the
yellow shirt, yeah.
It was just, what a clever way to include your original character costume.
Yeah.
I just can't fault it at all.
But there was plenty of things. There was plenty of little Easter eggs. Yeah. For example, at the end when, you know, Claire says she wants self-defence lessons and she goes up to the telegraph pole and pulls off the thing and it said Colin Wing.
Which I didn't pick up on. You told me about this.
You know, within the comics, he's Danny Rand's partner, and therefore, you know, Danny Rand obviously being Iron Fist, which is the next Marvel TV show. So, So yeah, they're playing it really cleverly, and obviously we've got another Daredevil, and you know we've got Defenders to look forward to. So
and we've got a Punisher TV show now as well.
Yes, absolutely.
That's going to happen. So yeah, more from Marvel, strength to strength.
Absolutely,
good stuff. Shit.
Well, I'm glad we agree on something.
Well, indeed.
It had to happen eventually.
Yeah, I suppose.
Right, that'll do for this episode's look down the TV and movie stuff. What I want to do now is go through some of what to me have been the best comic book series.
Well, why don't we do that?
Of 2016. The first one of which was Unfollow, which is a DC Vertigo title that I've really enjoyed. And the premise of this is that an aging billionaire sends a message to 140 people on Twitter to say that they are now all going to be taking a 1/40th share each of his fortune, which amounts to a hefty chunk. And he invites them to his private island, and he's sort of literally at death's door, and announces to them that they will have this share of his money, but that should any of them die, then the share gets split amongst the remaining ones that are alive.
And so it's paid forward to the remaining.
Precisely, and therefore the more people who die that are on that list of 140 people, the greater the share the rest of them get. And obviously, being that greed is a great motivator, we suddenly start to find that people start getting bumped off. And what's interesting is the cover of each issue is done as if it's an iPad, but then down the bottom you'll always have the count of how many people are alive. And so it started off with 140, and then it sort of worked its way down. It was for a few months it was 129, and then I won't tell you what happened, but it suddenly now it's dropped down to 86. Mm. And they all met, and there's various sort of strange characters in there. There's ones you like, there's ones you don't like. There's this strange masked man who's lurking about the place. You aren't really sure what his motivations are. And it's a real sort of dark, twisted tale. It's
so now this sounds to me, and correct me if I'm wrong, but this does sound to me very much like comic books starting to be informed by television.
Yeah, yeah.
Because this really sounds like something that would just transfer perfectly to an episodic weekly kind of thing.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Let's hope comic book writers aren't getting lazy. But obviously, you've read this, and what do we think of it?
Oh, I love it.
You love it?
I love it, yes. Yeah,
it's the sort of thing that I would like. Really good. Because this sounds like you're saying that can be a collected kind of thing and have a beginning, middle,
potentially,
and end.
I don't know what... You know,
don't know where it's going to go.
I know you don't like episodic comic storytelling. You know, you're a trade waiter. You know, you like to know there's a finite number of issues. Exactly. I don't know if their plan is to run
spin
this...
Spin it off or, elsewhere, you know, after 140.
Well, you know, we don't know if it's going to run for 140 issues.
No.
So,
anything you could liken it to in the world of comics that you've read before?
Not really. I mean, it's pretty unique in as much as, you know, if you've got a story and the main protagonist will narrate it.
Yeah.
Well, rather than it being narrated out loud in a thought bubble or anything, you will see people's tweets.
Oh, okay, well, that's a nice... That's
and therefore, when you cut to someone else, you will see, you know, their name at such and such, and then the tweet, and therefore what they're thinking and what they're going through is told through their tweets, and then you'll sort of get into their, you know, actually them talking to people and that sort of thing. So,
well, I do hope the writers are smart enough to somehow cram Trump's tweets in there and have him killed off. That'd be awesome, wouldn't it? Yeah, that's one thing we can do to save 2017.
Nice. Right, the next comic series I really enjoyed was The Vision, which was a reimagining of the synthetic Avenger, you know, the robotic Avenger. It was supposed to be an ongoing series written by a guy called Tom King, but unfortunately, when he was about issue 6, DC made him an offer that he couldn't refuse and offered him an exclusive contract to only write for them. And so he knew the story he wanted to tell, but obviously it was supposed to be a first story arc and then carrying on, so he only did the first story arc and the series ended, so it's only 12 issues.
So that sounds like a bit of me, doesn't it?
Yeah, because but it does tell a very interesting story. It's quite dark and sort of sci-fi in its storytelling, and it's basically Vision decides that he's lonely and wants a family, and so he creates a synthetic family for himself. They all look like him. They're all sort of green and red. And he has makes a wife for himself called Virginia, and a son and a daughter called Vin and Viv. And he also creates a robotic dog called Sparky. And they move to the suburbs in Virginia, just outside Washington, D.C., and it sort of starts off with this couple coming round and welcoming them with food, and them thinking, oh, you know, they obviously don't know we don't eat food and that sort of thing. They bought like a cake or something. And then as they walk away, the little caption just says, in 4 days' time, both these people died in a mysterious house fire and that sort of thing. And it's obviously all related, and it's kind of telling this story as it unwinds of how they're trying to assimilate into a normal life and sort of a normal neighbourhood, but how their interaction with the neighbours and causes various problems.
The proverbial fish out of water kind
of. But adding in the fact that Agatha Harkness has told the Avengers that she's had a premonition that the Vision is going to destroy them all, and so they're monitoring the situation as well, and it's sort of how...
So is this Vision... In this 12-issue series, the Vision that we know from the Marvel Cinematic Universe, he has got affiliations with the Avengers in that way?
Yes, but not the same origin.
Not the same, okay.
This is the Vision from the comics.
Okay.
But yeah, it's just very dark and twisted and sort of quite tragic and... Yeah,
Asimovian.
Sort of very, very like that. Very sort of iRobot kind of thing.
As soon as you said that he creates a wife, I'm thinking of, I think, is it Maria from Metropolis?
Yeah.
That's kind of what I'm envisioning, that sort of.
It's very offbeat, and it was a real sleeper hit, but it's suddenly, as soon as people realise how good it was and jumped on, the price of it has absolutely shot up. So
there we go. That one does sound very interesting to me.
Good.
I like that. And I like that because it is a collective thing and I haven't got to go any further to
cool.
to enjoy.
The next title was Civil War 2, a sequel to the comic book series that obviously you're a fan of. And
that
I
you love so much.
Yes. Yeah. But this one was quite interesting in as much as it wasn't... Obviously, the first one was about them arguing about the Superhero Registration Act. This one was about an Inhuman, a guy who absorbed the Terrigen mist that the Inhumans are pumping out to try and turn people into Inhumans. And this guy has premonitions of the future and he can sort of forecast events where things are going to go wrong. And there's a group of superheroes who think that they should use them to stop these events happening.
Right.
And there are others who are saying that not knowing the full context of his visions, are they going to be causing more harm than good?
Is that not the plot to The Dead Zone?
I can't remember.
With Christopher Walken.
With you.
I think it is.
Right. But yeah, so the main thing about it is that a lot of major Marvel characters are killed.
Oh,
or,
okay.
Or sort of changed in a great many ways.
Don't tell me too much about this one.
Oh, okay.
Because I genuinely would like to read this, because okay. I really liked the first one. Right. But you say you quite like this.
I didn't read it.
Okay.
I'm only mentioning... I mean, these are titles, much like you're talking about video games...
Yeah.
...that I feel had an impact. I mean, some of them
right.
I've read. I mean, in fact, the majority I've read, but some I haven't.
Okay.
And this is one of them. Like I say, I wasn't a fan of the first one, so I was never going to read this. But if you hear about two very, very major, you know, superheroes that you will know were killed, and it's changed the status quo within the Marvel Universe... basically, it spun out into all the titles are going through sort of a thing called Divided We Stand. So there's a big division amongst the superheroes, and the effects will be very long-lasting within the Marvel Universe.
But as we all well know, they'll always come back, won't they? Possibly, mate.
Time will tell.
It will.
Time will tell. Right, the next one is DC Rebirth. This was a reboot of the DC Universe. Now, back in 2011, the DC Universe had a reboot that they called the DC New 52, whereby they made significant changes to a lot of their characters, and they had 52 new titles.
One thing I just wanted to ask you very quickly about the New 52 is because I don't know a great deal about it. You're saying that they made a lot of changes to the characters. I'm interested, did they change some of the origins as well for the characters?
Yes.
They did?
Yes,
okay.
They did. And yeah, so they then decided 5 years later that they were going to reboot it again. And one thing that was quite controversial was the fact that they decided that the New 52 universe was actually going to turn out to be something that was imagined by Dr. Manhattan from The Watchmen.
Oh, fuck off.
And so he actually created that. So what they've done is, whereas The Watchmen has always stood on their own,
outside of,
they are now part of the DC universe because he as a character apparently imagined it, and now he's decided he isn't imagining it anymore, and therefore he's gone back to how things are. And it has proved to be very popular. I mean, when they first started coming out, you couldn't get them for love nor money. Everything sold out. They went to about 5 printings.
I don't like the idea of that at all.
Most of the titles. And yeah, you've got things like Wally West, who was lost in the time stream, he came back. Tim Drake, who was Robin,
yeah.
He's been pulled out of the timeline and he's now imprisoned, and everybody thinks that he's dead. And so within the storylines, everybody thinks he's dead, but we know that these sort of godlike characters have said, you being here is ruining things, and so you know you can't be here, and they've taken him away. So it's kind of completely changed the status quo, and it's rewritten a lot of the origins that were created for the DC New 52. I mean, I don't buy DC because 2 reboots, don't need it. So I knocked it on the head.
In all honesty, comics wouldn't keep evolving, would they? Unless they wrote these odd kind of plot twists and you know, differing places for the characters to
Absolutely.
Go. But I don't buy Dr. Manhattan dreaming a universe full of characters.
No.
I also am a little bit kind of not offended, but a bit put off by the fact that, as you said before, Watchmen has always stood outside that universe.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the DC Vertigo universe. Was Watchmen? No. It wasn't.
No.
It was just DC on
yes.
its own. But it very much did stand outside
yes.
that universe,
yeah.
where in the Watchmen universe, Batman was a film, a comic book character.
Yeah.
No, that's a really shit move, I
yeah.
think.
I agree, which is why I'm not buying any of them, but I thought I'd mention it because it's been very popular. Next one I've got is Spider-Man.
Oh, you like him,
the clone conspiracy. Now, this has been touted all year as being called Dead No More, but they decided to go with the clone conspiracy. And what's happened is Dr. Miles Warren, the Jackal, who was responsible for cloning both Spider-Man and Gwen Stacy back in the 70s, he's back and he's not really cloning people, he's actually reanimating their corpses and sort of, so they're coming back to life with all their memories. So rather than being a blank page, they actually know their history. And it started off with him bringing back Gwen Stacy and Captain Stacy. Then Spider-Man found out that he had brought back Dr. Octopus, he was attacked by Dr. Octopus, and then you see them all, and pretty much every ally or villain that Spider-Man has known that's died, Miles Warren is bringing them back. So suddenly all the characters who died in Spider-Man are dead no more. They're saying that this will have long-term repercussions within the Spider-Man titles.
Never mind what they are saying, what do you think of that? Because you, without doubt, to me, will always be the go-to guy for, is this right for Spider-Man?
I've been treading a bit of a fine line with Spider-Man since they rebooted it after the Secret Wars thing, whereby he's suddenly this Tony Stark-esque global billionaire running Parker Industries. And I don't really buy that. I like Peter Parker being down at heel and struggling to make ends meet, and that makes him be inspired. Now he can create all these gadgets and he has different types of web fluids and he can jet everywhere on the company plane and that sort of thing. And it's kind of taking the edge off it for me, but you know, I'm going with it. So
I like the idea of that. I do. When I saw the title, the Clone Conspiracy, I wondered if it was anything to do with the Clone Saga.
Yeah,
which it obviously is.
Yes.
So I quite like the Clone Saga. I know a lot of people hate it, but again, that's one of those things that is a collected kind of story, isn't it? And you've got does pop up every now and again in other titles, but it is a collected story. So this to me sounds like, again, something that I probably would quite like.
Miles Warren was always the Jackal.
Yeah.
And there's lots of clones of Miles Warren running about, but the guy who's the Jackal has been running around in a big Jackal mask, and we've always assumed it was Miles Warren under there. And then in issue 3 of Clone Conspiracy, he had a confrontation with Peter, and they were having a fight, and Peter suddenly said, "How are you so strong? What's going on?" And so he took off the mask, and do you want me to tell you who it was?
No.
Okay.
But I'll tell you what, you can tell the audience.
Oh, wait. So, yeah, we're seeing how we go with that one. And my last one...
It's very rare that I actually say to you, no, I don't want to know, isn't it? Normally I'm like, yeah, fuck it, just tell me. But no, I don't want to know.
No, obviously, if you're going to read it, you know. Yeah,
I would like to read that.
The last one is Captain America, Steve Rogers. Now, Steve Rogers hasn't been Captain America for a while because his super soldier serum ran out and he became an old man, as per his years. And
I never knew that was a thing.
Okay, and therefore, yeah, sort of Sam Wilson, the Falcon, has been Captain America for a while. But then Steve Rogers, as part of a storyline earlier in the year, got his powers back, and he's young and normal. And so they relaunched him in a title, Captain America, Steve Rogers. And in the first issue, he went on a mission. They had to get a Hydra scientist, and they got this guy. And Captain America's on this plane with another sort of hero called Jack Flag. And suddenly Steve Rogers, Captain America, turns around and just pushes Jack Flag out the back of this plane, you know, when they've just sort of flown away from this exploding building. And Jack Flag obviously, you know, they're up high and he falls out. And then Steve Rogers just turns around to this Hydra scientist and says, "Hail Hydra."
Dun, dun, dun!
And that's how issue one ends. And the writer got death threats.
I did read something about this.
Literally, people just lost their shit and went absolutely nuts. Oh. Now, issue 2 then explained how this could happen, but then it's been carrying on since there with sort of everybody thinking Captain America's a good guy and he's actually...
a Hydra agent.
Yeah, it's a Hydra agent. So, interesting times. So that I am getting and I'm enjoying it. So
Just to very quickly pick up on the fact that you said the writers there got death threats.
Yes.
Very similar to obviously the thing that happened in the gaming industry with No Man's Sky.
Right.
People really need to get a grip.
Absolutely.
Now, I am a huge movie fan, a huge comic book fan, a huge gaming fan, as you are, but Can you ever imagine being so upset with something that you would give someone a death threat for it?
No.
So this is just a very brief, impassioned plea.
I've been upset enough with Spider-Man that I've stopped buying it.
Of course, yeah.
Which is entirely my prerogative.
Yeah.
But the idea that you feel so passionate about something that isn't real...
Yeah, exactly.
That you just go, right, I'm going to kill you because you've changed one of my favourite comic characters. Get a fucking grip.
Indeed. I mean, I know very much so. Me more than you will sit through each episode we've recorded in the past and probably each episode we record in the future. And I always sound angry and upset and annoyed and like a whiny little bitch, and I swear a lot and I moan a lot about shit. I don't want anyone dead over it. So this genuinely is.
You and I may get passionate about things, but the bottom line is we know it's not real.
Yeah.
We know it's entertainment.
Yeah.
We're allowed not to like it and not be happy about it,
yeah.
But to wish someone dead in the real world based on something they're creating in a fantasy world.
And I'd like to finish this little segment here by just saying that is also one of the things that made 2016 so fucking awful. Can you all just get a fucking grip and just love things a bit more? If you don't like something, just don't get involved with it.
There's too much hate out there.
There is too much hate. More love, please, for 2017.
Indeed. Right. Well, that's it for this week's episode. We'll finish off next episode, part 4 of our 2016 review, and then it's back to normal.
Whatever that is.
So, for Geek-Minded Fools, I've been Graham.
And I've been Scott.
Thanks very much for listening, and we'll see you next time.